well-being of anyone. Thus, we would like to focus on the impact of climate change to children to find solutions for their life security at least. So, firstly, I would like to present you the expert panel who is going to introduce the topic under discussion in this working group this morning. As I said before, we are split, so we are supposed to stay the whole day together. First part and second part to make it a whole in the evening. We will also have an expert panel, as I said, in the afternoon. This morning's three speakers are Ms. Yoni Pegram from UNICEF UK, Ms. Brianna Fruen from Climate Youth Activists from Samoa, and Ms. Rekka Dillon Ricketson. Where is she? There. Ms. Kelly Matheson from Climate Youth Activists from Our Children's Trust. Thank you for joining us and for providing your experience and your expertise. The expert resource person assisting us today is one of the panelists, Johnny. Thank you for supporting us. Rapporteur for this working group is CSC member Clarence Nelson, Judge Nelson, together with an OCRC colleague, Nina Sluger, who is running around the whole day. I do not know where she's running right at the moment. She's here. And Joseph, who is going to do his best to stop you to speak too much. At the end of the day, they will present a preliminary set of conclusions coming out from the debate within this working group. The end of the day means both working groups together. After the statements by our eminent panelists, I will open the floor to all participants. Please raise your hands if you would like to take the floor, and your name will be taken by one of our collaborators. Please note that you will be allocated a maximum of 2 minutes, and I am adamant. I am a very nasty chair. 2 minutes. If you go beyond this time, I will have to interrupt you, as I will have to interrupt our panelists if they go over their time. I do not have a red card, but at least I can work with a yellow one. That is more or less all from my side. And I would like now, because we have lost a lot of time already, 8 minutes, to introduce our first speaker, Ms. Yoni Pegram, UNICEF UK, as I said. Ms. Pegram leads on developing and promoting evidence-based policies, conducting research on the impacts of climate change and environmental degradation on children, and advocating in international climate negotiations for children's rights to be reflected. The floor is yours for 8 minutes.
All right, I will speak extra quickly then. Thank you very much. It's a real honour to be here on behalf of UNICEF and to address what is certainly one of the greatest threats to child rights and for future generations as well. I wanted to start with the first slide, please, with a quote from the president of Vanuatu following Cyclone Pam in March last year. He said, "All the development has been wiped out. We will have to start again." And I think that represents very much the scale of the challenge we're facing. And this slide is really meant to represent the multiple ways in which children's rights are undermined by the impacts of climate change, from access to food and safe water, health, education, survival, development, a real range of photos there which show. And I think everyone in this room is probably very familiar with the links between climate change and child rights, so I won't spend too long here, but I think there's a couple of points worth emphasising. So first of all, children are obviously disproportionately affected by the impacts of climate change, and the Human Rights Council has recognised that. And that's because childhood represents a unique period of rapid physical and mental development, so their bodies are particularly vulnerable. For example, in terms of malnutrition arising from drought, which is becoming more severe and prolonged with climate change, this is responsible for over half of worldwide deaths of children under the age of 5. And children are literally more vulnerable. They require more food and water per unit of body weight than adults. And for those that survive, the impacts can be lifelong. Undernutrition in the first 2 years of life can lead to irreversible stunting, which is obviously low height for age, and that affects their physical and cognitive development, so that's a real impact that lasts their entire life. in terms of disease, vector-borne diseases such as malaria will increase in range as global temperatures rise. And those diseases are already concentrated on children. So 78% of deaths from malaria in 2014 were among children under the age of 5. Similarly, you have a photo here in the top right corner of severe weather, which is increasing in frequency and magnitude with climate change. And these will obviously lead to physical and psychological trauma for children. And there are also indirect effects in the aftermath. For example, there are heightened risk from exploitation, violence, and abuse as a result of family separation or migration as families seek to cope with the impacts. Now, linking conflict to climate change has been the source of some debate, but there isn't a significant degree of consensus emerging among experts that impacts of climate change can act as a threat multiplier in fragile situations. And of course, in terms of education, schools can be destroyed and families displaced. And not all children are affected equally. We heard in the plenary this morning that girls are much more likely to be taken out of schools by families to make up for lost income when their crops fail, and they have to walk further to fetch water and fuel. And obviously, there are specific needs and vulnerabilities of children suffering from poverty and Indigenous children as well. There's a couple of other ways in which we have to emphasize that children are disproportionately affected as well. In numerical terms, regions and countries most exposed to the impacts of climate change tend to be characterized by a large number of children as a share of their overall population. And finally, of course, today's children and future generations will experience much more severe and recurrent crises in their lifetime. So this is really an issue of intergenerational equity. Next slide, please. So despite this situation, children's rights are typically overlooked in international and national policies on climate change. And just to give one example, the latest round of communications to the UNFCCC, intended nationally determined contributions, which are countries' pledges that they put forward as part of the Paris Agreement, illustrates this point very well. Less than one in three include the word child, children, young person, youth, girl, boy, adolescent. And I know this because I did a very painstaking search last week. And many of those references that do appear are very superficial at best and only in passing. Only two of those documents mentioned intergenerational concerns. On the flip side, policies and initiatives that are designed to address children's rights, for example, child protection or healthcare, only touch superficially at best in general on environmental issues such as climate change. So there's a lack of information and disaggregated data on children most at risk and the measures required to address their specific needs. And we're also lacking mechanisms to support children's full and meaningful participation in climate dialogue and initiatives. So the next slide, please. And that's despite the fact that children and young people themselves feel very strongly about climate change and how this will impinge on their future. We polled over 5,500 children in the UK and over 60 countries a few weeks ago, using YouReport, which is a messaging service that allows young people to speak out on issues that matter to them. Of those that responded, 77% think that climate change is one of the most pressing issues for young people today, and 98% think that governments need to take urgent action to address climate change. So we have to really ask if their right to be heard is being fulfilled currently. Next slide, please. So despite this gap, there is recognition that is evolving. Although climate change was not mentioned in the convention or other key human rights treaties, as Professor John Knox set out in the plenary, human rights bodies have made clear that states should protect against foreseeable environmental harm, including those caused by climate change, and their obligations can be categorized. And I will do this briefly, as Professor John Knox already covered them. States have obligations to adopt measures to protect children's rights from the harmful effects of climate change, and this speaks to both adaptation and mitigation measures. They also need to ensure that the measures they take in response to climate change themselves respect children's rights. So we're safeguarding against situations in which green projects might be pushed through at the expense of local communities and children's rights. And in fulfilling these obligations, states have procedural duties, including assessing climate-related impacts on children, making that information, climate-related information, public and accessible to them, and upholding their right to participate and be heard. And they need to provide access to effective and timely remedy for harm. They have obligations to protect from harm caused by corporations as well. And although these obligations apply to all humans, they have a heightened duty when it comes to children. Now, further progress is being made. The Human Rights Council resolution this year welcomed the adoption of the Paris Agreement and decided to pursue a discussion and analytical study on climate change and children's rights next year. And obviously today, the day of general discussion represents a significant step forward and a contribution to this body of work. Next slide, please. Now, the committee has already provided some useful elucidation. It said in its general comment number 15 that climate change is one of the biggest threats to children's health and exacerbates health disparities. States should therefore put children's health concerns at the centre of their adaptation and mitigation strategies. Next slide, please. And since then, the committee has issued a number of more detailed concluding observations, principally to developing countries, and these emphasise measures to protect children's rights in national climate and disaster risk management policies, to ensure their views are taken into account, and to increase their awareness and preparedness through education, to seek international cooperation in implementing these recommendations, and in a new development, which is, I think, very exciting, they've begun to address mitigation in more detail. This year, the committee made a recommendation on climate change for the first time to a developed country, to the UK, citing its concern at the impact of air pollution on children's health in the UK and its contribution to climate change affecting various rights of the child in the UK and in other countries, and it recommended placing children's rights at the heart of its international climate strategies, including the framework of its international climate finance. Next slide, please. In parallel, there have been significant developments in international climate change negotiations as well, and the Paris Agreement adopted last year recognised the application of human rights in the context of climate change, including children's rights and intergenerational equity. Currently, there's no space in the UNFCCC to address rights in a cross-cutting manner, and I think this is a key gap and opportunity requiring further work. Next slide, please. And finally, other relevant national and international standards also provide guidance for states. So the Sustainable Development Goals that were adopted last year recognise climate change and development as intrinsically linked, and Goal 13 sets out a target on building capacity, including that of youth, to participate in climate change planning. And finally, the Sendai Framework for Disaster Risk Reduction, which emphasises that children and youth are agents of change and should be given space and modalities to contribute. I want to just finish by saying that taken together, all these developments offer important opportunities to improve coherence between states' obligations under the CRC and their efforts to tackle climate change. The challenge and next step is really bringing these strands together and translating these words into the urgent action required. And I have to say that the Committee on the Rights of the Child has already started to assist states to take a more joined-up approach by explicitly linking its most recent concluding observations to the Sustainable Development Goals, including on climate change.
Great, thank you.
I think it was quite a lot of information, very, very dense, and it's going to continue this way. So thank you very much. And I'm giving now the floor to our second speaker, which is almost a child, because she has just passed her 18th birthday. It is Brianna Fruan, climate youth activist from Samoa. She's one of the founding members of 350 Samoa and was leader of environmental group Future Rush at age 11. Yeah, Samoa is a small island and has to hurry up with climate change methodologies. Future Rush and 350 Samoa conduct projects to help combat climate change and promote sustainable development through awareness-raising programs in schools and communities in Samoa and in the region. The floor is yours.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and Tala Falava. It's an honor to be here, and I'm very grateful for the opportunity. As of recent years, climate change is a word you can't go a day without hearing, seeing, or experiencing in the Pacific. Heat waves, flash floods, longer droughts, rising sea level, and intense tropical cyclones are now a part of every Pacific child's life. During COP21, Pacific delegates highlighted that as tropical oceans warm, there is a trend over the last several decades of increasing tropical cyclone intensity of the highest category cyclones in the South Pacific. Science is clear that climate change will likely lead to increased frequency and intensity of the most devastating tropical cyclones, such as Cyclone Pam that hit Vanuatu. Exactly 3 months after these discussions, and a week after Fiji became the first nation to ratify the Paris Agreement, Tropical Cyclone Winston hit the islands of Fiji. Winston tore through Fiji, affecting the whole community and especially vulnerable groups, children and women. Case studies taken from the stories of Winston survivors highlighted this. A man spoke of how he grabbed his children and told them, "When I say run, don't run to the neighbors, but run underneath the house and seek shelter." Rumail Kivi recalled, "I just lay there with my children and prayed." In this situation, the children's rights to safety and security was taken away from them. Another woman spoke of going into labor the evening of the cyclone and having complications with her baby, saying, "I was unable to nurse my son. The nurse explained to me that because of the trauma brought on by Winston, I was having complications." From the frontline stories of the survivors of Winston, it is evident that the effects of climate change robs affected children of their basic rights to nutrition, safety, security, shelter, and in the case of the 10-month-year-old that went missing during Winston, the basic right to survival. There is a common misconception that children will live with the consequences of climate change in the future, when the reality is children are dealing with the consequences as we speak. Children aren't just the future of climate change consequences and solutions, but the present. The only way forward is to include the future in the future plans. As the saying goes, nothing for us without us. I started my work in environmental advocacy when I was 11, starting off in my small school-based environmental group that me and my friends started. We were a bunch of primary school kids that loved our island and wanted it to be preserved for generations to come. So we started small school projects, including recycling, composting, and created a carpool registry. From there, we partnered with other schools, expanded, and even had community activities. From a young age, I experienced the influence a few 11-year-olds could have on their communities. I think what made our environmental venture so successful was the teachers, parents, media, and local citizens that support us and gave us the platform to become agents of change. Children and youth have the capacity and the passion to be the world's biggest agents of change, but they just need the resources and platform to do so. I think the first step to involving children and creating agents of change is having clear, comprehensive, and frequently updated climate change education in our school curriculums. As weather patterns change, so should our curriculum to match the new challenges our climate faces, so our children can be equipped in adapting and mitigating to environmental change. This education must be altered in different countries, so information is relevant to every child's situation. Also keeping in mind the inclusion of traditional knowledge and teachings, as it is of great importance to many of our traditional societies in rural areas, which are the most vulnerable to climate change, as they have little to no financial means or informative resources to adapt to the effects. The root of change is always education. But to create mass agents of change, where every child is a part of our changing environment or a part of the solution, we must also remember that classroom and teacher, or talk and chalk, formal education is not the only form of education. Children must be given means of educational tools such as practical activities and field trips to spark interest and ideas. Governments and stakeholders can give children the platform to start environmental groups, publish books for children by children, involve children in the big conference of parties, translate formal UN documents to child-friendly language that fellow children can read and easily understand, and overall, a platform to feel like a child's voice is heard. The sooner we start involving our future in the plans for the future, the bigger leap forward we have for a sustainable environment and sustainable development. Where a 21-year-old environmental law intern already has 10 years of experience because she joined an environmental policy group when she was 11. I truly do believe that this is the generation that will change everything. With the help of governments and stakeholders and all of you here today to provide the platform and education and non-formal opportunities to which children can thrive to be agents of change and make a brighter future for their environment and for the next generation of children. Paftai Lava, thank you.
Thank you very much. That was a mix of good ideas and complaints. And I do think we have to take it seriously. I'm now giving the floor to our next speakers that are two, and they have a complicated system of dealing with their issue. It is Rekka Dillon Ricketson and Ms. Kelly Mattison. Rekka is a climate youth activist and has blogged and written about the impacts of climate change and environmental degradation on children's rights in Canada.
She has presented her work on climate change to the UN committee. She is also the founder and organizer of the annual Girls Climate Summit at her high school. Rekha is one of the claimants on whose behalf the organization Our Children's Trust has filed several cases before US courts to protect against inaction on part of the US government to protect children from climate change. Kelly Matheson is president of the board, Our Children's Trust. She is also an attorney, filmmaker, and human rights advocate with a specialty in environmental human rights and the use of video in criminal justice investigations and proceedings. Criminal justice is quite a good tool, I would say. I am a criminal judge, a good tool to do something concerning climate change. I give the floor to the two of you because you have divided the work in for yourself, and it will be 12 minutes altogether.
Very quickly, Rekha is one of hundreds of you that are leading
microphone, please.
Landmark
microphone.
Work to secure concrete.
Thank you.
Sorry about that. Rekha is one of hundreds of you that are leading landmark work to secure the right to a clean and healthy environment and address the most pressing human rights issue of our time. One of her colleagues, Esha Shirley, taught me a lesson that I will never forget and try and follow every day. She taught me that a true listener listens with the willingness to help. So that is what I'm asking of all of us today, is that we listen to Rekha and all of our youth here with the willingness to take bold, aggressive, and decisive action to address the climate emergency that we are facing. And I'm going to turn it over to Rekha.
Hello, esteemed guests. I am very honored to be here to speak to you today. Thank you very much for this opportunity. My name is Rekha Dillon Richardson. I stand here before you as a young student, a woman, a daughter, an activist, an environmentalist, and most fundamentally, a human being. I was raised along the stunning coastline of British Columbia, Canada, where I developed a profound respect for the natural world. Even at a young age, I realized that the planet we live on is a beautiful and sacred gift that should not be taken for granted. I continue to feel most inspired and empowered when I'm in the natural world. It is in the raw beauty and diversity of our planet where I feel most calm, most alive. These are the places we need to protect for generations to come. As many great leaders, including Indigenous leaders, have pointed out, climate change is the defining issue of our generation. It is no longer an issue for the distant future. It is here. Just take a look at what has been happening in our world recently. Fort McMurray, a small city in Alberta, Canada, home to the tar sands, burned to the ground from an unstoppable wildfire, displacing its residents and destroying homes, businesses, and wildlife. Extreme floods in Louisiana are decimating modern infrastructure, damaging property, and taking lives. Jaden, a 13-year-old victim of the recent Louisiana floods and plaintiff for Our Children's Trust, states, "A few weeks ago, I literally stepped out of my bed and was up to my ankles in climate change." And next to the Standing Rock Sioux Reservation in North Dakota, an oil company is trying to complete construction on a pipeline that would transport crude fracked oil under one of the largest water tables in the world, the Missouri River. We know that all of this will only worsen if we do not change our behaviors, our laws, and our relationship to nature. Everything is on the line. The human race seems to have a preconceived notion that we are at the center of the world, the most important thing that matters. But this is so wrong. Our individualism and inaction pose an imminent threat to the current generation and the very survival of future generations. The scariest thing, perhaps of all, is that all we have to do to make this terrible climate nightmare a reality is absolutely nothing. In the West, we have to continue living our high consumer and high carbon lifestyles. We have to continue to ignore the truth and abuse our privilege as citizens of this beautiful earth. I just don't understand. Throughout our lives, most of us have been taught to treat others and our surroundings with respect and not to take more than we need. How could we ever rationalize the destruction of our home and the natural resources we depend upon for survival? Children across the globe have trusted all of you, the adults, to make the right decisions, to lead us forward into a cleaner and more just future for everyone. Unfortunately, seeing the rapid destruction of the planet right before my eyes, I can't help but be direct and say, we are failing. The inaction around climate change is a colossal failure and a fundamental violation of my human rights, the human rights of my generation, and the generations that will follow me. Yes, everybody makes mistakes, but the onset of climate change is much bigger than a couple of mistakes. Our society is largely built upon colonialism, greed, wealth, and taking. Ignorance around the repercussions of our behavior is not an excuse. Eventually, climate change will be irreversible, but not yet. I have hope. But we need to stop just talking and pretending. I urge you, it is imperative that we start doing. Everybody here today holds a position of authority, and with that, the potential to do something really powerful. My human rights and the rights of all children can only be upheld if we make concrete changes. To do this, we have to implement quantifiable greenhouse gas emission reductions that are based in science. Leading climate scientist James Hansen and many of his colleagues have provided a prescription for all nations on this planet to follow. A prescription for restoring the atmosphere, stabilizing the climate system, and protecting the oceans from acidification and warming. It requires us to return atmospheric carbon dioxide levels to below 350 parts per million by the end of the century and limit the long-term temperature increase to 1 degree Celsius. To my knowledge, the only government in the world that has adopted this scientific prescription for climate recovery into law is the city of Eugene, Oregon. I also believe that it is absolutely crucial that children are actively involved in the solution. I am standing here today speaking for all the young people who could not be here. It is my generation that will become the lawyers, doctors, politicians, mechanics, scientists, and teachers in the future. The fundamental human rights and futures of children are being disproportionately threatened by climate destabilization, even though we had little to do with the production of the problem. My generation is ready and willing to fight for our human rights and for the rights of our Earth. In fact, we are already standing up. Right now, 21 young people are suing the United States federal government for violating their constitutional rights to life, liberty, and property. I am part of an Our Children's Trust lawsuit against the Pennsylvania state government that is requesting strict regulation of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gas emissions. Both of these lawsuits emphasize the legal obligation of governments to their people to accept responsibility for their actions and become active participants in the solution instead of perpetrators of the problem. I have been active on these very issues since middle school. In 2012, at the age of 13, I came before this very body to speak about how urgent addressing climate change is to the successful protection of children's human rights, much like I'm doing right now. At the session, I was one of the only youth present, which surprised me. I asked myself, why aren't kids given more of an opportunity to voice their opinions regarding issues that deeply affect them? My experience at the United Nations in 2012 inspired me to take action. With the help and support of my high school, I organized the first Girls Climate Summit at my school in 2015. The mission of the summit is to strengthen the knowledge and leadership skills of young women who are passionate about the environment. I hosted the second annual Girls Climate Summit this year, attended by over 70 participants from over 16 different schools in the greater Philadelphia, Pennsylvania area. At the two annual Girls Climate Summits that I have hosted so far, I noticed something that I believe is fundamental to change: hope and education. When I looked at the girls who attended the conference, I saw unmistakable sparks of passion and inspiration. When you give youth a safe space to voice their perspectives and prioritize their ideas in a real way, magical things can happen. Creative solutions emerge, and we begin to see a different path forward. I sincerely appreciate this opportunity to speak to you all today. You need to be willing to continue to give youth this safe and meaningful space to express their ideas and the real power to implement them. In order to alter the trajectory of climate change, we need everybody to be involved, especially the generation that is going to inherit the consequences of harmful decisions that were made without our authorization. I may only be 17, but that doesn't mean that my rights are not important and that my knowledge and experiences aren't valuable. It's time for governments around the world to put the future of young people above short-term economic interests. It is time for youth to have a permanent and powerful place at the table. help us, stand in solidarity with us, and most importantly, act now to make these changes real. Thank you.
I would like us to take a moment to remember that the UN and the UNFCCC was set up because we knew that there were challenges that were too immense for one nation to handle alone. And in fact, the very primary purpose of these establishments was to secure the widest possible cooperation from all countries to keep the atmosphere healthy for both present and future generations. Yet, decades have gone by, and the states have failed to take the uncomfortable actions needed to stabilize the climate, and instead, states have actually backed the fossil fuel industry's efforts to exploit the very resources that we should be limiting: oil, gas, and coal. In turn, we are creating an unsustainable world and racking up violations of children's rights at an accelerating pace, as has been shared by our youth representatives here. Since those of us who have had more yesterdays than tomorrows are failing, just really failing to protect our atmosphere, Reka and her generation is pursuing an outside-of-the-box, game-changing global solution by taking their case to court to secure judicial mandates. Judicial mandates that will protect the atmosphere. With the support of our Children's Trust, kids in countries literally spanning the globe are asking judges to order states to honor constitutional guarantees, treaties, and laws that promise children the right to life, liberty, and a chance at happiness. The headlines reinforce what the youth have known, that this is the most important lawsuit of our time. Their request in court is the same request that they're making to this committee. They're asking this committee to require states to base policies on climate science, which is common sense, right? As Reka highlighted, our chance for climate recovery is based on a prescription that the world's top scientists put forth. We must do two things. We must reduce our parts per million to 350 parts per million by the end of the century, and we must limit the increase in temperatures to 1 degree Celsius. Young people have shared this scientific prescription with all of you here today, and I believe that this needs to be thoughtfully read and then acted upon. Each of us is here today because we want to protect the fundamental rights of children, so we cannot settle for carbon math that is politically convenient, that is politically comfortable, or that is politically possible. Instead, what we need to do is swiftly and unequivocally draw a bright, bold scientific line in the sand that will protect our children and their fundamental rights. And then we need to require states to act upon this line with all deliberate speed. To do otherwise is going to sacrifice our children's future. To end, author Terry Tempest Williams wisely shares, "The eyes of the future are looking back at us, and they are praying that we see beyond our time. Thank you for your willingness to see and your willingness to help."
Thank you very much. Thank you to all the panelists for your statements. I have noted two words only, maybe for a discussion before I hand over the floor to you. And this is hope at the one side and greed at the other. So let's see what we get out of it. And thanks to the interpreters, I hope you're not completely exhausted already now. We will go down with the quickness of our speeches. I hope you agree. Thanks a lot. Okay, we have 1 hour, and I hand over to Yoni to introduce the second part.
Sure, thank you. So I think we've set the scene quite well, and it's always very inspiring to hear from youth themselves and Wes, Brianna, and Rika, I think, have done an excellent job in framing the discussion. Now, the purpose really now is to look at the guiding questions which were in the concept note. And what we're hoping to achieve is to have a better idea of what steps are required to strengthen coherence between states' obligations under the Convention, the responsibilities of the private sector, and action on climate change. Which actors need to be involved? What opportunities are there for them to contribute? And which alliances need to be built? How can children's capacity to act as agents of change be strengthened? What are examples of good practice, and what is the role of the committee? And that's really a cross-cutting question. So I'd ask that if you intervene, you could be as concrete as possible in your interventions and really try to address some of these guiding questions and even explicitly say which one you're trying to address. And that will help us to take note. And obviously the aim of this discussion is that we can formulate recommendations on the basis of your inputs. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I would like now to open the floor for the open discussion. Concerning this open discussion, I also would like to give you an information for all those who would like to continue the conversation via Twitter, Facebook, Google, because they can participate, and whatever other social media they are using, please the hashtag DGD16. So with this we can continue. And we also ask you to commit, please, to children's rights and the environment. Write a commitment you will make to children's rights and the environment, whether it's in your professional or personal life. And then you have your photo taken. Your photo will be included on the Storify page on the DGD and the Twitter, and tweeted on DGD16, hashtag DGD16. Pens and papers are provided at the back of the room. I'm not so sure if it's this room or the other room where we have been, 19, to write your commitment. We will find out. There are sheets of paper with my commitment. And if you do not have any commitment, maybe you have some plans that you would have a commitment one day. So that was not to forget. If you have questions for our panelists, as well as comments, best practices, experience that you would like to share with us, please raise your hand. Please also remember to make recommendations which can be incorporated in the outcome of the DGD. Once again, 2 minutes, and don't waste 2 minutes with telling something about your organization or your personal work. 2 minutes are very short, and we need good recommendations at the end of the day and a list of good practices. This is what we want to have. Okay, I open the floor now, and I have the first one, Ben Schachter from OHCHR. Where is he?
I'm over here. Thank you very much. Ben Schachter, I'm with the UN Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights. I unfortunately am going to have to do exactly what you said I shouldn't. I'd love to talk more about these issues, but 2 minutes is short. I wanted to announce that we have an expert meeting on human rights and climate change, October 6th and 7th. This is a 2-day expert meeting taking place in the Palais de Nation in room 24. It is open, and we would invite you all to participate and join. I think this discussion is particularly timely, given that the Human Rights Council resolution on climate change this year is on the impacts of climate change on the rights of children. So I also wanted to announce that yesterday, a note verbal and questionnaire was sent out to all member states, and we will also be sending the questionnaire to international organizations, CSOs, and national human rights institutions to collect inputs for an analytical study on the impacts of climate change on the rights of children that the office will be submitting to the June session of the 2017 Human Rights Council. We'll be having a panel discussion on this subject as well at the March session of the 2017 Human Rights Council, and we welcome inputs for that, and I think this discussion should feed in very nicely to that work that we're doing. So I just wanted to share that basic information with you all and invite you to join and participate. At the expert meeting, we will be having a representative of the Committee on the Rights of the Children, Kirsten Sandberg, to address what's happening here today, and we'd like to continue to draw these connections in our work. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I have now Camille Seliger.
Madam Chair, I speak on behalf of the International Baby Food Action Network. In its recent report, Unless We Act Now, the UNICEF highlights that today over a billion children live in extremely high flood occurrence zones, and nearly 160 million live in high or extremely high drought severity zones. Among them, newborns, infants, and young children are particularly at risk, given their early stage of development and immaturity of their immune system. Babies exposed at drought, water stress, floods, and severe storms are more likely to develop non-communicable disease and vector-borne disease, and they are more likely to be malnourished. In such crisis situation, there is a natural solution to provide babies the best nutrition and medicine. It's breastfeeding. Whenever natural disasters strike, it protects babies' health and helps them to survive and thrive. Supporting breastfeeding mother to establish or reestablish breastfeeding is therefore absolutely essential. In such crisis situation where water is lacking and where babies are exposed to malnutrition, non-communicable and vector-borne disease, the use of milk formula can be deadly. On the contrary, breastfeeding constitutes a real lifeline for these babies in disasters. And what about the impact resulting of the food production? Already in 2006, the FAO stated that the livestock sector is a major stressor on many ecosystems and on the planet as a whole. Globally, it's one of the largest sources of greenhouse gases and one of the leading causal factors in the loss of biodiversity, while in developed and emerging countries, it's perhaps the leading source of water pollution.
It's come to an end.
Yes. IFEN Asia studied the impact of formula feeding in 6 countries, and as a consequence, it revealed that about 3 million tons of carbon dioxide were annually released, which is equivalent to 7 million miles driven by an average passenger vehicle. This is just to show you the extent of the impact.
Thank you. Thank you. Can you please tell your name? I do not have it.
Hello, everyone. My name is Mansour Saifi, a human rights activist from Iran, and my speech is about just to not waste time and get to gist. I would like to mention you some of the main issues which South Azerbaijani children are suffering up to this day. Just I wrote some of them, and I go to them. The rights to education in mother language. As we know, the only educational language in Iran based on Persian or Farsi, the language which is totally different than any other ethnic minorities' languages. This is one of the hot issues, which is really very important in regions where parents are not familiar with this language or they are not unable to speak in Farsi and they cannot have a connection with their own children in the educational levels. Children are vulnerable with the adverse impact on their education, physical well-being, sexual exploitation, abduction, and subsequent exploitation by human trafficking bandits. Children get involved in washing car glasses, selling cigarettes, and are even get drowned by adults and doing some stuff like drug dealing in the street, working in a brick furnace more than 14 hours in a day. I am one of those cases. Azerbaijani girls working in a carpet factories from the age of 5 years old. The West Azerbaijan province is confronted with the severe problem of using drugs and narcotics drugs, which cause the risk of addiction among the children too. 4,488 children were coerced to marriage under the age of 15 just in 2014. Girls by the age of 15 in East Azerbaijani cities is likely to have 2 kids of 5 and 1 years old. Most of the village girls undergo marriage with men often 10 years older than themselves. Children suffer incalculable ill effects because of unduly subjected to sex, pregnancy, giving premature birth, or even violence in house by husband or other member of the families. And what important is that also lack of a secure living environment, rough situation in childhood, sexual abuses, family economic poverty, migration to large cities, lack of any pragmatic policy, and no glimmer of hope to signify possible progress are some of the main and key factors that should be considered. And Islamic Republic of Iran is the responsible for these issues' consequences.
Thank you. We have to link, and please don't forget, we have to link to climate change, and we have not heard very much about climate change at the moment. So let's come back to climate change. Thank you, nevertheless. I have now a little bit of a complicated name. I have a problem. I hope I can pronounce it. Shamista. Where is she? Shamista Shiva Ma Krishnan, more or less.
Ma Krishnan. So I'm the UN Youth Representative for a Cambodian NGO called Caring for Cambodia. And instead of, I guess, extending my statement, my main question is for those working in Southeast Asian countries or in the ASEAN region, how can we integrate best practices implemented or, I guess, developed on by civil society into national youth policies? I've been working in the youth space for quite a bit of time now, and I guess as also a graduate student, it's I wonder to myself, how can an NGO like Caring for Cambodia really integrate some of the great things that we've done in the climate space in on the national level? So we work with the Cambodian government. We have an MOU signed with them because of our education system, but we also do a lot with WASH issues at all of our schools in Siem Reap. So this is a question. I'm hoping it maybe produces some effective responses, and looking forward to hearing more thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm collecting the questions, and we'll ask at the end if one of our panelists maybe will have an answer. Thank you. I have one, two for the moment. And please, please do not forget, three. One, two, three. Okay. Please do not forget, we have five important questions. Five important questions to address. What steps are required to strengthen coherence between state CSC obligations and the responsibility of the private sector? That is one of the issues that we have, we should take into consideration, because that are our biggest problems. And which actors need be involved to just get to these questions and to the answers? And how can children's capacity to act as agents of change can be strengthened in this regard? So state obligations, business sector, what kind of actors, what is the role and the assistance of children, do we have good practices in this regard, and what can the committee do? That would be the main parts that I would like to discuss, first of all, to come back to our main issue. So we had one lady I gave the floor. Where is she? Yeah. Go ahead. Please present yourself.
My name is Priscilla Rodriguez. I'm an environmentalist attorney too. And this question is for Ms. Madison and for Dylan. I'm sorry, I don't know how to say your name. But the girl, the advocate girl. So the first question is about what are the outcomes so far about the trial? And I have another question for both of you, and it's in terms of how it's been this legal process in terms of like challenges, both for attorneys and for children working together, and if the judges have been supportive and implementing the best interest of the child as a principle. Thanks.
Thank you very much. I'm collecting four questions. If there are, there was a second lady, yes?
My name is Annabelle Webb. I'm the Director of Human Rights and Climate Change at Just Planet. But more importantly, I'm the mother of two children aged 10 and 12. I join my colleagues in urging this committee to respond to the looming catastrophe of climate change, which threatens the most fundamental rights of children, their right to life, survival, and development. And like the presenters before me, I'm asking the committee to help us face climate change with swiftness, courage, and tenacity. Article 6 of the Convention requires the committee to prioritize mitigation of climate change and to push states to meet obligations under the Convention through implementation of science-based greenhouse gas emissions targets. Climate scientists tell us that states' refusal to reduce carbon emissions from fossil fuels are, quote, extraordinary, winning, intergenerational injustice. States are directly responsible, contributing $5.3 trillion annually in subsidies and investments to fossil fuels in 2015, according to the IMF. That's greater than the total health spending of all world governments combined. These subsidies simply must stop. States who continue to subsidize fossil fuels are in breach of fundamental rights under this convention. Any state support for carbon-intensive fracking or tar sands exploitation must be categorically defined by this committee as in breach of obligations to protect children's right to life, survival, and development. We're asking the committee to ensure every state party before you, especially states who support and subsidize fossil fuel development, and those who are disproportionately responsible for global carbon emissions, are pushed to make a swift transition to renewable energy. Similar to the committee's recent concluding observations on the United Kingdom, we ask you to hold accountable wealthy nations for their extraterritorial climate impacts. Finally, we ask you to include in all future concluding observations a standing section on climate change and environmental protection. We're here to ensure the rights of our children so that we can look them in the eye and say, we've done everything we can to secure your future on this planet. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I can, in any case, give a very quick answer. CRC committee is dealing with the issue with member states already now. We are going to continue to do that. I have one blonde lady and then a gentleman behind, and then the next round. Okay.
Thank you, Madam Chair. It works? Yeah. I'm making this statement on behalf of International Disability Alliance. In relation to the question for the discussion, we would like to raise issues faced by children with disabilities. They are more exposed to risk and to being left behind, to the less of access information, resources, services, and limited adaptive capacities. We just heard from Mrs. Brianna Froyen about the Cyclone Winston and how families ran with their children. But we know that in Fiji and in other cases, such as 2015 Nepal earthquake, many disabled children experience abandonment by their families. That's why it is pivotal to ensure their rights. To do that, we ask the committee to ensure that disaster risk reduction policies are accessible to and inclusive of children with disabilities, as set out in the framework for action adopted at the UN World Conference on DRR in Sendai, Japan. The second point we would like to stress is the importance of inclusive social protection policies. It's well known that children with disabilities are more likely to live in poverty and their situation are exacerbated by climate change. Therefore, general and targeted social protection policies are crucial to address the needs of communities affected, particularly of children with disabilities. Moreover, as required by both the CRC and CRPD, children with disabilities have the right to express their views and must be consulted, including in all steps of policymaking related to the environment. We urge the committee to raise these issues with the states for the explicit inclusion of children with disabilities in these policy measures and for their capacity building to be agents of change in facing climate change. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. The last for the first round, please.
Muy buenos días. Mi nombre es Rodolfo Mendoza y hablo.
Rodolfo Mendoza is my name. I am speaking. I'm from Peru. Yesterday, I was in the meeting which launched the general comment number 19 on the responsibilities of states and greater resources to be allocated for children's rights. I believe that that meeting from yesterday dovetails perfectly with the meeting we're having today. We've heard many analyses of the situation pertaining to climate change, but in particular in connection with children, because children are more vulnerable than because of their nature and because also of their development of their body and their mind. I think states have this duty to provide additional protection for children. So linking this with yesterday, I believe that one of the demands that we could put forward is that states set aside greater resources for children, and in particular in connection not only with climate change but also in connection with the production processes of many companies that work in countries, especially the extractive industry companies, when they affect the human rights of many children and many populations, when they extract resources from the soil, especially on the land of indigenous people. So my recommendation, therefore, would be that the environmentalists and the jurists, the legal officials, and the people we've heard this morning, the special rapporteur from the UN we've heard this morning, who summarized all the laws, all of these people are telling us what we should do. But we should also listen to the economists, what they say. All of this in order to consider the best interests of the child in all the activities that we are currently looking at today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'm coming now back, because we have the first round done, I'm coming now back to the questions. And first of all, I would give the floor to Joni. There was the question, is there any possibility to have best practices and youth policy combined? So that's your field.
I see from the... Yeah.
Three minutes?
Yeah, sure. I won't. That's fine. Thank you for the question. It's definitely a challenge. My suggestions would be, obviously, you need to look at means to raise visibility. Am I on the mic? Could you put the microphone? It's on. to raise visibility of your action, can you cooperate with others that you can work with that are working on similar issues? Can you seek out mechanisms for youth participation, for your voice to be heard? For civil society, are there mechanisms for civil society to feed into these discussions? And if there aren't, can you call for these in cooperation with others? And also seek out other actors that may be sympathetic to your cause, national human rights institutions, for example. Also, obviously, use the Committee on the Rights of the Child, the mechanisms through reporting. So seek out different mechanisms to have your voice heard and cooperate with others would be my two key points.
Thank you very much. Can I hand over to Kelly for the second question? The trial, outcomes, challenges, and judges assisting. Judges cannot be assisting parties. But for the rest?
Thank you so much.
3 minutes. Yeah.
Thank you so much for the question. Lots to answer in 3 minutes. Broadly speaking, the young people are winning on substantive grounds. If they lose, it's purely on procedural grounds. And so they're getting kicked out for some crazy reason that doesn't make any sense according to the law. There have been precedent-setting wins in countries like the Netherlands, the Urgenda case. There have been precedent-setting wins in Washington State. In Massachusetts, the young people won a unanimous decision in front of the Massachusetts Supreme Court. In Pakistan, they actually just, at the Pakistani Supreme Court, made it over a procedural hurdle. And in the United States, we just had a significant hearing, and we will know in 60 days whether this case is going to trial. If this case goes to trial, and I 100% believe it will, it's going to be the first time climate science is going to be on trial in a court of law. Regarding the legal processes and the challenges, I think there's two that I want to mention. One is that the government is saying this case shouldn't be in court. This case should be heard in the halls of Congress. The Department of Justice lawyer for the United States actually said that the plaintiffs, the youth plaintiffs, made a wonderful case that should be heard in the laws of Congress, and the judge responded, it has, implying that Congress is not listening to what these young people are saying, so that this case actually does belong in court. Regarding how the judges are responding, it really falls into two different categories. In America, we have this saying called a hot potato, which means that the case becomes in front of the judge and they just want it to go away. It's too complicated, it's too big. CNN had a headline, "This is the most important case in the United States." That's a lot for a judge to take on. But the judges that get it, they listen and they do what Esha taught us. The judges that are really listening with the willingness to help are hearing these young people. They're allowing their voice to be heard. They're giving them access to justice. They're giving them access to democracy, and they're giving access to participation. And those are the judges that are making thoughtful decisions about these cases.
Thank you very much. This was quite an answer, I think. And gives us assistance to hope as well. I have now one participant here, a lady.
Thank you. Ivana Savic, PhD candidate, Leiden Law School. Climate change has been recognized also by the CRC committee, especially in the concluding observation as the rights of the child issues. And of course, we have recognition of the climate change as human rights issue. However, what have not been articulated, I think, in depth was what kind of impact does climate change have on the children's rights and children's well-being. On one hand, climate change is an issue on its own, but it's also a cross-cutting issue, so it needs to be addressed in these kind of two ways. So mapping of the climate impact is quite important, and also connecting the different aspects and different regimes applicable to addressing the issues of influence of the climate change. Also, another thing that I think it's quite important is to also recognize the environment, including the climate change, as one of the underlying principles of the Convention of the Rights of the Child. Although the CRC does not recognize the right to environment as a right, it can be derived from other rights. And we also have in the preparatory work, we saw actually that there have been initiatives to recognize, especially when the convention was developed, the right to environment, but that didn't go through. So basically, some of the recommendations are to adopt the general comment on the environment and the rights of the child that would also cover the issues such as the climate change, also energy, actually access to energy and access to modern energy services, because we also heard from the first session that there are a lot of issues surrounding the energy, energy services, including issues on health and premature deaths are also connected to the issue of energy. Then we also have the issues that needs to be covered within the environment, climate change, urbanization, and also different sorts of pollution. Additional thing that also needs to be articulated, I believe, is the adoption of the fourth optional protocol to the Convention of the Rights of the Child, to the right of environment, because we have seen that there have been recognition to right to environment, but it's not specific what environment means, and then we have different practices around the world, and this issue needs to be kind of harmonized, and that's why it would have a great added value to have additional protocol. Then one of the recommendations is to develop methodology for short, medium, and long-term right of the child impact assessment. Yeah. And also to develop environmental rights of the child indicators, and also strengthen the participation of children at local level, especially environmental decision making and access to justice.
Thank you very much. I have now another participant. Go on.
Thank you very much.
And you tell us your name, please, first.
My name is Claudia Duarte.
No, sorry. It's the young man in front of you.
Sorry.
Just give a brief introduction. I'm Janet Schembri from the President's Foundation for the Wellbeing of Society in Malta. MRITOS includes the provision of a safe space for dialogue, and this includes children. That's why we have Matthias here. We strongly support the recommendation of creating a safe space for meaningful child participation and empowering children to speak. And now Matthias will tell us a few words on this.
Hello, my name is Matthias and I am 10 years old. I come from Malta. In 2016, I became part of the Child Council. I would like to present a summary about a project which the President of Malta started and also experiences of other children from Malta. The President's Secret Garden. The President of Malta, Mary Louise Colero Preca, saw that in Malta we lack open natural spaces as it is a very crowded small island. During a meeting of the Child Council of the President's Foundation for the Well-being of Society, the children discussed children's environmental rights. Many issues were discussed, including traffic and pollution, lack of the natural environment in our village and cities, lack of safe spaces such as safe pavements for children with different abilities, such as wheelchair users. Therefore, we children appreciate every natural environment and safe space there is in Malta. Her Excellency, the President of Malta, wanted to open something fun, safe and spacious for children to enjoy. The President chose her nicest garden for activities and called it the President's Secret Garden. The garden's environment is refreshing and quickly brings a sense of happiness to whoever enters it. Sometimes you make a new friend or find another talent like weaving. And once again, I say that this is very beautiful and has a positive experience. EcoScola. I form part of the EcoSchool program. In my school, every month, we have a meeting. During these meetings, and we create charts that are later used as posters. Such other activities include meetings with groups in my community, such as the local church. During such community meetings, topics related to cleaning and taking care of the community environment were discussed.
Matthias. You have slowly to stop, because there are other speakers as well. Okay?
Okay.
What would be your last sentence?
I would like to say that there's a lot of important things, and I like that I am here and I am sharing my opinion.
Thank you very much. It's very good to have your opinion. And I think the recommendations to have a child council for dealing with environmental issues is a very good recommendations that we can take on board already. By the way, the garden of the president opened her own garden, and the garden of the president for the children is quite an issue in Malta. I give the floor to the next lady. We have to go back to the 2 minutes.
Thank you very much. My name is Claudia Ituarte Lima. I'm a researcher at Stockholm Resilience Center. So I have a concrete question and one suggestion. My question is, we have heard a lot about the important interactions between different rights of the children. And I would like to ask the question to the panelists. What do you think about these also complex interactions between different environmental thematic issues, specifically biodiversity, ecosystem, and climate change? Because we see that nature-based solutions are often best at addressing natural disasters and so on, and in building resilience and environmental justice. So I would like you to hear your thoughts on that, and a concrete or partial answer to the question of which actors. In this sense, group of actors is the Joint Liaison Group, that it's where the CBD, the Convention of Biological Diversity, the Climate Convention, and the Convention on the certification are trying to join forces. Another is the Intergovernmental Platform for Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services, which, unlike the IPCC, on climate,
is open not only to scientific knowledge, but to other knowledge systems where children's views hasn't been sufficiently discussed, but that could open an avenue. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Brianna, can you take over this question then a little later? The question? Okay. There was another, somebody from here, because I never looked there. Who was the one who wanted to have the floor from this part? Nobody? Okay. Then there was somebody there. Yeah, this lady, please, then the gentleman, and then you. Okay?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would like to specifically ask a question regarding... Andrea Carmen from the International Indian Treaty Council, Yaqui Pueblo. I'm on the panel this afternoon, but I would like to ask a different aspect. Based on the recommendations from June 8th, 2015, from the Committee on the Rights of the Child to the Government of Mexico, relating to the case that we presented about the import and use of pesticides that have been banned for use in other countries, specifically recommendation C, and it's regarding the relationship with the private sector and a strategy for moving forward. Recommended that Mexico further examine and adapt its legislative framework to ensure that the legal accountability of business enterprises involved in activities having a negative impact on the environment in light of its general comment number 16 on state obligations regarding the impact of the business sector on children's rights. We've met with the government of Mexico together with the impacted communities, which is also my community, regarding the difficulty from the human rights sector on the federal government level of implementing this recommendation because it's seen as a commerce issue rather than a human rights issue. And this was presented to the UN Working Group on Business and Human Rights when they did an official country visit last month in Mexico, requesting that they supply recommendations to the government of Mexico on how to move forward with this type of recommendation. So my question for the committee and the panelists is there examples of a collaborative piece of work on business accountability regarding health of indigenous children that has been used in other countries, or how could a framework be developed moving forward in collaboration with the Committee on the Rights of the Child and the UN Business and Human Rights Forum and Working Group? Thank you.
Thank you very much. The next one, where was she? No? There was somebody behind you who wanted to have the floor? Not yet? Okay, then.
Hello, yes, thank you. My name is Susana Borda, and I speak on behalf of CNE, a nonprofit organization launched in May 2016 under the impetus of Colombian scientific diaspora based in Switzerland to educate Colombian children to the protection of water and support them to become agents of social change in their communities and by contributing to policymaking on the issue. CNE's strategy is primarily focused on the empowerment of Colombian youth through science. Starting January 2017, CNE will organize science projects centered on water-related themes throughout schools in the country's regions most affected by water shortage and contamination. Teenage children will be involved in research projects, therefore ensuring that scientific research is made accessible to underprivileged in the most economically underdeveloped regions of the country. While supported by teachers previously trained in team management on basic water issues and a scientific mentor specialized in environmental sciences, the water teams will identify water-related problems specific to their communities. The water teams will then carry out research projects for 1 year, by the end of which their results will be made public. The activities undertaken by our organization are based on the belief that youth, if they are provided with the adequate pedagogical and logistic support, are ideally placed to identify and investigate environmental issues affecting their communities from bottom-up perspective, grounding their research in an understanding of local cultures and norms. CNE equally holds true that if provided adequate support and guidance, adolescents possess the ability to carry out scientific research that is methodologically sound, ethical, and relevant to the advancement of the state of knowledge on issues linked to local and national water degradation and conservation. So we would like to contribute to two of the guiding questions of today's discussion. The first is which actors need to be involved and what opportunities exist for them to contribute. So we would ask for the international scientific community and particularly scientific diaspora from developing countries. Should be involved in accompanying children and youth in understanding and acting upon water issues. And this can be achieved through the use of digital technologies in the classroom. A number of applications such as Skype in the classroom or Google Hangouts allow for quality synchronic communication, including video, among the children in the classroom and the scientists at very low cost.
Thank you very much. I have to be equal as much as I can. We have now finished the second round. I don't forget you, but we finished the second round, and I would hand over now to Brianna for the question that regards her thematic interactions.
Yes.
With the different problems.
I couldn't agree more with what you said about biodiversity. And there is such great importance in ecosystem-based adaptation. In Samoa, during cyclones, the first trees to go down are always the invasive trees, and the ones to stand are always the indigenous ones. So I think we have to start looking into going back to our roots and recognizing, you know, what in our biodiversity is native and what is not, and removing what isn't, and keeping and investing in what is. In many traditional societies, they already have practices to monitor the relationship with their environment. And I think there is an importance of going back and looking into those relationships and looking into those practices and involving them in our education systems. There is a great importance in acknowledging traditional and non-formal teachings, you know, looking into our past to find solutions for our future. And this is as I highlighted in my presentation. I hope that answered your question.
Thank you very much, Kelly, about the framework.
Instead of talking about a specific case study, I'd like to talk about the framework in general. States are active participants in the infringement on all of our rights because they subsidize, they authorize, they encourage, they invest in actions that violate our rights. And they do this through policies and plans and thousands of permits. So I actually want to suggest we just go back to elementary school grammar and we change some nouns. And by that, what I mean is that instead of subsidizing fossil fuels, we subsidize renewables. Instead of exploring for new hydrocarbons, we explore the new generation of energy sources. Instead of investing in deep water extraction, we invest in deep emissions reductions. Instead of encouraging deforestation, we encourage reforestation. And I think the bottom line is that instead of fighting against our children, as our governments, our states, and our fossil fuel industries are doing in courts of law, that we fight for our children. So I'm hoping that that's a big picture of how we can change the framework in a business and human rights context.
Thank you very much. I am not allowed to take the floor and to answer the questions concerning CRC. I am asking my colleagues, maybe Kirsten or Hind or Susanna, would you like to answer the questions concerning Protocol 4 and the possibilities the CRC has now? That was the question. What is the CRC doing? No? Hind? Maybe?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Merci beaucoup. Merci.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank you for all these questions. As has been stated on several occasions, the Committee on the Rights of the Child has for some time and increasingly been paying more attention to all environmental issues, notably the role of the private sector in protecting the rights of the child. These are questions which are constantly being put to state parties. They're asked not just about public sector enterprises, but also our committee focuses on the increasing responsibility of the private sector to protect the rights of the child, and in particular the right of the child to a clean environment. We are including, we've lost the microphone for the speaker.
Okay.
So as I was saying, we're including the achievement of the Sustainable Development Goals as a priority. In all our recommendations, we draw state parties' attention to the need to work towards these goals, in particular Goal 7 and the others directly linked to the environment. So we establish this link between the rights of the child and the right to a clean, sustainable and prosperous environment, which will help the development and health of children.
If it is permitted for me to say something also concerning protocol number 4 that was suggested, maybe in the meantime we do not know when and if we could have a protocol number 4, but in the meantime we might have protocol number 3 that we have already, and maybe it would be a good idea if a child has a claim against the state because of pollution, whatever kind of, to address the Committee of the Rights of the Child via protocol number 3. That might be a possibility. I am a nuisance to my own group because it's a huge amount of work, it will be, but maybe this way we can develop some kind of jurisprudence in this regard. Thank you, and I'm going to the next and most probably last round, giving the floor to this young gentleman there.
Thank you. My name is Sebastian Deck. I'm working with the Center for International Environmental Law. And I'd like to thank the committee for dedicating a day of general discussion on this very important issue, as well as congratulate all the panelists for both very inspiring but also presentations, but also for highlighting very specific actions that should be taken to respond to these challenges. Yoni Pegram highlighted very well that the Paris Agreement already explicitly emphasized the duty of states to respect, protect, and take into consideration their obligation related to children's rights specifically when taking climate action, but also that we lack at the moment in the climate change negotiation process any particular space to have a cross-cutting discussion about what those obligations mean very concretely in relation to mitigation, adaptation actions, in relation to transfer of technology and finances. Since many years, civil society organizations have worked together with supportive governments, with UN experts and UN organizations to promote the recognition of the linkages between human rights and climate change under the framework of climate change negotiations. One of the issues that we have faced is the lack of understanding and of expertise among climate negotiators for human rights-related issues. And so my suggestions or questions to the CRC will relate to this. Building on the fact that the Paris Agreement specifically mentioned the rights of children, I would like to ask the CRC if there is any plan for the committee to engage more proactively and more directly with this negotiation process and with governments, as they now have to work out the details in order to operationalize the Paris Agreement. There's a couple of things that the committee could probably do. One is to continue to really promote the understanding and assessment of good practices of experiences in relation to integrating human rights consideration and children's rights consideration in climate policies when it considers national reports. And I will echo the proposal made previously to really keep focusing on this particular issue in the consideration of national reports. This will help understand how governments can build on the synergies between realizing children's rights on one hand and protecting the climate on the other hand. And secondly, since the climate negotiations now need to really develop all the modalities to operationalize the Paris Agreement, I'm wondering if the CRC, I would like to ask if the CRC has any plan to really directly provide feedback to this process in the coming months. Thank you.
Thank you very much. What the outcome of the deliberations will be, a direct answer we will see at the end of the day. Before, I cannot say anything for sure. Anyone who wants? Yes, sorry.
Hi there, my name is Alistair Whitby and I work for the World Future Council in the Rights of Child team. I'd like to make two recommendations for specific best practices. And one of them relates very specifically to one of the guiding questions, which was how children can become agents of change. And this one relates to how children can both become agents of change and also environmental stewards. And the policy that I'd like to highlight is Maryland's Environmental Literacy Standard, which in 2011 introduced a mandate that all students become environmentally literate by the time that they graduate. And what they've done in Maryland is introduce a very comprehensive program of environmental education that goes from kindergarten through to 12th grade, and it kind of involves a lot of outdoor education. So every year at every grade level, kids get the opportunity to go outside and in a very kind of hands-on, visceral way, learn about the environment, but also each of them has to come up with a program of how they would like to improve their local environment. It's integrated across the curriculum as well, so it's not just in the biology class, it's across the curriculum, and it's a very interesting policy that we should all be looking at. It also, in terms of one of the questions, involves a very broad group of stakeholders, because it's not just the teachers, but it's local NGOs, it's business groups that are involved in actually implementing some of the activities in the environmental literacy. The second one, I'm very glad that several people have mentioned the potential for legal challenges to force action on environmental degradation. John Knox this morning, also Ms. Dylan Richardson and Mrs. Matheson. I would just like to raise Argentina's Supreme Court's pioneering judgment on environmental rights. More than three quarters of the world's national constitutions, 149 out of 193, include references to environmental rights. Now, some of them specifically say that these rights aren't enforceable, but there is also a lot of opportunities for action around here. Argentina's Supreme Court upheld this constitutional right to an environment which is healthy, balanced, and suitable for human development. And the case is very interesting because it led to very specific on-the-ground actions. Thank you very much.
Thank you. A very interesting issue to take into consideration, I think. Maybe NGOs can help us to collect, first of all, judgments of their own states, and also to collect or to tell us if yes or no environmental issues are contained in their constitutions or in their laws somewhere, because as you have seen before, legal issues is a matter of the Convention of the Right, or the Committee of the Rights of the Child. Anyone else? Jorge?
Gracias, Presidenta.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm Jorge Cardona. I'm a member of the Committee on the Rights of the Child. I'm sitting here at the back. When I was listening to the requests being made to the committee, I felt overwhelmed by the responsibility. What can we do in the climate change negotiations? Well, we have our mandate in the committee, and it's not very extensive. Nonetheless, I do think that there is an important issue linked to the main area of activity of the committee, which is to examine the periodic reports of state parties and to draft concluding observations and recommendations for them. I believe that we need to forge an alliance between the committee and the organizations represented here. It's very difficult for us to get to know the reality of each state party in detail. However, the reports that we receive from civil society rarely concern the environment. This is because you are organizations working on children's rights and not on the environment. And those organizations which work on the environment rarely submit reports to our committee. I remember around 6 months ago when we were meeting with civil society organizations prior to the state party hearing. The NGOs talked about children's problems, but children talked to us about environmental problems. They talked to us about the problem of waste, about pollution from mining activities. They were the problems that they felt. Nevertheless, they weren't referred to by civil society organizations. So I would like to round off, Chair, by saying that we need greater interaction between environmental experts and the committee. When we examine the state party, we should have been informed already of complaints being made in the area of environment so that we can help develop case law, which will also help states in this area. Thank you.
This direction now, because I never see, is there any interest in asking a question or giving a comment? No. This direction? John?
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I just wanted to emphasize the point that just was made by Jorge Cordona, and I would expand it to include a plea for interested civil society organizations to make similar interventions on the environment with respect to other treaty bodies with jurisdiction and also within the Universal Periodic Review process. However, I would also point out that it would facilitate that kind of information from environmental and human rights organizations if the treaty bodies, including the Committee on the Rights of the Child, helped to clarify the norms and standards that apply in this area. In other words, it's a two-way street, because obviously it helps the committee to have more information, but it also helps the groups to organize that information to have further guidance from the committee so that they know what kind of information the committee finds most useful and what standards the committee will apply. Thank you very much, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Quick answer to that. Maybe we can make a combination between your studies that I would recommend to read and a general comment number 16 on the businesses, because there we have already standards. And maybe somebody would like to read those general comments as well. Thank you. Anyone else from this group? Yes, please. And then the last one from here.
Is it working? Yeah. Hi. Daniel Fai from FIAN International, human rights organization, advocating for the right to food and nutrition. Just a quick input on one of the guiding questions on the role of the committee in holding governments accountable for children's rights in relation to climate change. I think one aspect would be for the committee to strongly emphasize and also recognize states' extraterritorial obligations to respect, protect, of states in with regards to their effects in climate change, and also maybe to briefly build on other comments. And FIAN has been including, you know, states' extraterritorial obligations already in its in reports, parallel reports to the Committee on the Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, and this is something we're looking forward to maybe include and hopefully work with this present committee.
Thank you very much. We'll answer to that. Anyone else? You? Kirsten? Okay, Kirsten, can you answer to this one? Because I am the chair.
Yeah, thank you for that question. I think this is something we already do with regard to businesses in general. And we should definitely start relating it more clearly to climate change and environmental issues. And we do not for all states include something on businesses, and we should be more, I think, aware that we need to include both that and climate change and also the combination of those two. And before, when Renato tried to give me the floor, I didn't understand what the question was, but there was also a question about whether we would make a general comment on climate change or on the environment in general. And we would certainly like to do that, I think, but we don't have the capacity at the moment to start on any new general comments, because we already have some that we need to finish, and then we'll have a process of deciding on a new topic. Probably we will only make one general comment at a time, and then we have to look at various different topics. But anyway, the recommendations coming out of this day will be public on our website, so we definitely plan to do follow-up to this day of general discussion. So in a few months' time, the report will come out with all the recommendations. I think there will be a preliminary report at an earlier stage, and then we will take it further from that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. First of all, greetings to our youngest participant. we are the Committee of the Rights of the Child, no? So, welcome any kind of children who would like to participate. We are coming to an end, and we are fantastically in time. We have collected quite some recommendations already, I think, and I do not know if, Clarence, you would like to give a few ideas of what you think, or only in the afternoon then? Yeah. Only in the afternoon. Okay, then it's up to me to finalize. I have noted also quite a lot of things, but the two words I have mentioned in the beginning are still on the plate. What do we do between hope and greed? How do we manage to get those two things together, hope and greed? Because all of us, we hope, and all of us, we are submitted to greed. So let's see what we can do, all of us. I would give you a few more informations for the break. We have lunchtime between 1 and 3. Please be back at 3 o'clock here in this room for the second part with the second group. But we have two side events that I can highly recommend. One is Under the Same Sky Constellation, Children's View, a Play, Urban Environments. It is in the room 19, the room where we have been before. And Unsound Management of Chemicals and Children's Rights is in this room. This is the second part in this room, with a special rapporteur also coming to us, Mr. Duncan, speaking about pesticides and other nice things. Sandwiches and beverages for those who are in the group are in front of the rooms 12 and 14, and 19, offered by Terre des Hommes. Thank you very much, Terre des Hommes. We are all thirsty and hungry. So let's close with this. Thank you very much to my panelists, to our panelists, better. Thanks, Clarence. You are not allowed to eat so much because you have to work. Can you say that?
Climate change video, yeah. Yeah, the speaking points. Yeah.
Okay. Yoni, the last part, please.
Sorry, just before the break. So in the plenary room, there will be videos on display during the break, which we encourage people to interact with. So there's a Voices of Youth project, and actually this speaks back to examples of best practice. This is about empowering youth, so it's rolled out around the world, and children and youth can document examples of climate change impacts in their community and what they're doing to respond to those threats, and they blog about them, and this is called Voices of Youth. And there's a climate change digital map, and it's nicely done, and you can upload it, and you can click on various countries and see about projects that are being carried out there and impacts from children. And here's a video that explains it, so I'd encourage you to explore the map afterwards.
Thank you very much to UNICEF.
I think it was quite good.
15 minutes to go, and then we start with the side events, if anyone is interested, I hope. And bon appétit.